Hi, the following podcast is brought to you by Radical Road Brewery, the best craft beer in the heart of Leslieville. Find them at 1177 Queen Street East. That's Radical Road Brewery.
Hey, I'm Lily Frost, and I just put out an album called Decompression. And I am living in Toronto right now and just signed a US deal for the record, which is fairly exciting. Just made a video in Italy for Open Highway. Welcome to the music.
Yes, Lily, welcome and congrats, a US label deal. That's awesome.
Yeah, it's not like a label. It's a company called the Royalty Network.
Okay.
And they deal with putting songs in TV and film, doing all the administration, shopping it, soliciting it. They're from New York and okay. They have an office in LA. So it's good.
And you've done a lot of your music has been on TV shows and movies that many of us have seen. So we'll make sure to chat about that. But congratulations on the album Decompression.
Thank you.
You would have thought that in mid 2020 that was it for you.
A
lot of us went through stuff. Greg and I, you know, we had Kim Mitchell on, we had Sass Jordan on. Ooh. I think cool. 2021 ish. And we asked them, you know, have you been staying at home and just thinking of ideas? And they were both like, we just wanted to rest. We just needed to get away from all of this.
True.
I read, Lily, that you were thinking that that's it for music. You can't perform live anymore.
Yeah, I just thought as I was lying on my couch watching Netflix that it was the time. It was a sign. It was impossible to perform live anyway. So but then as time went on, I realized that music for me isn't only about performing. It's something inside myself that I need to get out of myself and do no matter what, whether people are listening or not. Because when I made that pact to just quit, I became uneasy with life. So it's not something that I can quit. It's not really a choice.
How did that manifest? Like you felt you made that decision, that's it. Like what feelings manifested that you felt, nah, this is not right. I still need to write. I still need to create.
Yeah, I just started to feel really shut down, really disconnected from myself, from others, from life. And just some of the shows that I did do, which were in the moments between shutdowns, the first guy who offered me a gig was James B. He's a real character in Toronto.
Okay.
And I couldn't even believe he was offering me a show because I just couldn't wrap my head around how is that legal? How are we doing this? Oh, wow. Like, what are you talking about? Yeah. But it was in a geodesic dome.
Okay.
He's always got these crazy ideas. And everyone was seated outside at a huge distance and the band was all separated and whatever. Oh, wow. So I got my head around it and I thought I can't just do a normal gig because that's just too obvious and easy. Like, it's got to be something special because we'd already been locked down for maybe a year and a half or two.
Wow.
And I said to the band, like, let's just improvise the whole thing. We'll just make everything up. We'll be completely unprepared. And they were like, yeah, that sounds great. Let's just do that. And it was mayhem. There were moments of gold, but it really did wake us up, you know, to each other and to the moment. And James was like, next time, could you play some songs, you know? we can.
But that almost sounds like that might have been like a huge relief and a huge weight.
Yeah.
Just to play.
It totally was. to play, to actually play. And then as I, the other gig that I prepared for, I think it was the Heartwood and Owen Sound, I was rehearsing songs that I'd written, and it was so hard to do. Like, it took so much energy emotionally to get out of myself. I was crying and crying. Like, I just couldn't believe how exhausting it was. And it's this endurance that we took for granted almost that had gone away. And I've needed to build it up slowly. We all have, you know, how to integrate again, how to be social. Some people still aren't, you know?
Yeah. It's, I've only recently realized that, you know, we all didn't make it through with everything intact.
Yeah.
You know, some people, you know, unfortunately have, you know, lost family members and great friends.
Yeah.
But there was also like a huge mental health crisis that I think everybody to some degree sort of went through. It was weird. It was really a weird time.
Yeah, Matt, and you feel it more now, and it's the anxiety. For me, I don't think it was anxiety so much. It was more, I appreciated the rest, to be honest, because I feel like it takes a lot of energy to be an extrovert and to do shows.
Sure.
So my like common state or my most comfortable state is to be a bit more of a hermit or something, like to be a writer, you know? So to be the performer is a bunch of energy. I'm willing to do it. I know how to do it. I have my way. But some people are extroverts and they get energy that way. I'm just not that. That's not me. So, but I have friends who are super anxious, super depressed, just have changed seemingly forever. I feel like I kind of trimmed the fat. Like, I don't need to go for a beer anymore. You know what I mean?
Ah.
Let's just go for a beer. I'm good with like not wasting time.
Interesting. That's really, really interesting. Aaron Goldstein plays an important role in this album. How much of a lifesaver was he back in 2020?
Yeah, he happened to... Where did I see him? Oh, yeah. It was funny because it was on Instagram. These stilt walkers were going by playing hand drums during pandemic. And it was such a beautiful thing to see.
Yeah.
And I posted that on Instagram. And he wrote right away. He goes, those guys just passed my house. You must be a neighbor. And we said where we live. And it was like, and we're actually really close. Like, we should write a song or we should go for coffee sometime.
Yeah.
Because there aren't many, like, this is an old school neighborhood. Lots of, you know, Europeans and, like, you just don't really see hipster musicians around. It was kind of like, what? So we got together. We didn't write a song immediately, but we talked and hung out. And then, you know, I told him how I was kind of shut down and he encouraged me to come out of my shell. And, you know, he said that he doesn't really collaborate. He just produces. And I said, well, I kind of want to produce my own record next.
Yeah.
And he said, well, you could do that. But if you want me to produce it, I'd be into it. And I realized that I wasn't going to do it without him. So I said, let's do it. Let's do it that way. But my sort of agreement was I have to say every idea I have and trust myself completely and kind of get the final say. And he's like, okay, that's all right. So, and halfway through, he's like, you're kind of producing this. And I'm like, I know, I told you, like, I'm producing my record.
So sounds like both of you got something out of the deal.
Yeah, I mean, he's got a great space and he plays every instrument and he helped me. Like, for example, Drive All Night is one of my tunes. He gave it that driving rhythm. Before it was like a piano ballad. And he's like, no, this has to like feel like it's pushing forward. So he brought, you know, he definitely brought some energy to the project. Yeah.
Nice. Now, the sound Americana, that's a first for you. Is that right, Lily?
Yeah, like, I mean, I've always touched on jazz and mm-hmm. Blues a little bit, not so much, but this one's more folky and more country twang, a little bit of country twang than I've gone into. Like, I've done Western swing before, but Aaron definitely brought that. Like, I love the pedal steel. And we went into like a bit of banjo, a bit of mandolin, that kind of more of a folky country element than I've ever done.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And how did it feel to create that kind of sound and that kind of record?
I loved it.
All right.
Yeah. And it felt really laid back and sparse too. Like some of the songs like Open Highway, I really worked with Nick, the drummer, Nick McKinley, to lay back and just make it as minimal as possible. And I feel like we achieved that. You know, like, I feel really good about the record. I like it a lot.
That's awesome. I want to go back, Lily. I want to go back a bit, a couple of things as I was doing some reading. I'd mentioned that we had John Bora on last episode. And the conversation started around busking. TTC and just traveling and busking, and I read somewhere that you bused across Canada.
Yeah.
When was this, and how was that experience? That's fascinating.
So that was when I was 19. So a few years back, and there were four of us in a little Pinto, and our parents were like, "Get a job to pay for next year's university," and we're like, "See you later." And we just took off in this Pinto with no money, but we could all sing and play. So we basically stopped everywhere along the way to pay to busk and earn money for gas and food. And we did it. Like, we got across to BC, and we slept like in the gazebo in Banff. That was beautiful. Wow. And then we woke up and used like samples at the body shop just to like freshen up. And then we slept on the beach in BC on Jericho Beach. And the cops came by and they're like, "Hey, by the way, it's not exactly legal to be doing that." Whereas in Toronto, they would be way harsher. And we just thought that was kind of funny. We're like, "Okay, peace out, man." Yeah. Like, it was so West Coast. But then I ended up going and staying in Vancouver. Like, I loved it out there. I stayed there for 10 years.
Wow.
And I did busk as a first means of survival for about a year.
Yeah.
With a band, not the same guys. It was like this kind of rockabilly and then some friends from university in Montreal. And we just found outside the lineup of Cheap Tuesday movie night, you've got the crowd there because they're, you know, stuck. That was the perfect audience. And then that just built. And people were like, "Hey, you guys are good. Like, want to play our house party? Want to play our gallery opening? Want to play our club? Want to sign a record?" You know what I mean? Like, it just snowballed. And I was there for doing that band from 92 to 97. And we were like packing out venues and touring down to LA and back. Like, it really was that groundswell.
That's crazy.
That was a cool band. Wait,
Lily, so you never went back to the next year of university?
I never did.
Oh, my goodness.
I should have, man. Looking back, things would have been easier, maybe.
What does busking do for you as a performer? Like, what does it sharpen you? Because, I mean, no one comes to see somebody perform on the streets necessarily, right? They're walking by, they're lining up for Tuesday movies.
Yeah. So it sharpens you up to the immediacy of the moment. So you cannot play a boring ballad. You can't be introspective. It's like, what's going to attract their attention in the next 1 second?
Wow.
So you have to pull out all your like hottest harmonies, sharpest wardrobe, best audience connection, you know, jokes, moves, anything you've got that's like, I've always been good at improv. So it's like that. It's improv. You have to be in the moment and you have to be charismatic, or you're just going to lose them.
Wow.
You know, you've got seconds. Yeah.
Does that prep you for the stage? Like, does that prep you for, like, in front of a proper crowd that paid money to see you?
Yeah, like, of course, like, because within a crowd, you're always going to get, you know, some people are murmuring over there. They're not paying attention. So what are you going to do? Are you going to let that happen? Or are you going to approach them? And are you going to call them out? But like in an alluring way, right? Like, how are you going to deal with that? So I just always found that really interesting. My mom's really charismatic and she's always like cracking jokes and she's a great dancer. So it's kind of in that her side of the family.
Yeah. Wow. Another trip you went on that I read about was to Egypt back in the early 1990s. Tell me about that trip. That must have been different.
That was really different. So I was studying in Montreal and my boyfriend's manager is an Armenian Egyptian man who had an uncle who owns all these ships on the Nile. Wow. And they were looking for a Vegas style singer. And I had been studying jazz singing. So like kind of torchy singing. And all they asked for was a list of songs for the audition. And
that
I
was it.
Sent them a list of songs and they were like, sure. Okay, great. So I went over with Antoine, my manager, it's like friend manager. And cause he wanted to see his uncle anyway.
Sure.
And we pulled up to this ship. It's called El Basha, like the Pasha, the prince. And it's like green and gold and floating restaurant establishment on the water. Cause you don't have to pay taxes that way. Ah. And, I don't think they got me a visa either. So like all kind of under the radar.
Yeah.
But they had me singing seven nights a week, 4 hours a night. So four sets a night.
Oh my goodness.
Which I just thought was awesome because I could sing and that's all I really wanted to do. So, and they set me up with Rashad Fahim, who was the pianist who'd studied at Berklee College in Boston. So he was amazing.
Yeah.
And we just laughed and played music. And I mean, it wasn't easy in the sense of the day to day, like the customs and things that I take for granted here in terms of just, you know, being able to show my wrist right now, like would be reprehensible.
Yeah.
So when you shake hands, like your arm had to be straight or else you're like an loose woman because you'll be too close if your elbow's bent, this kind of thing. Things I didn't know. So I learned the hard way. I have stories. I have a book I'm working on. So there's a chapter about it. Yeah.
Well, that's amazing. When is that book coming out? What is it called? Do you have a title yet?
Oh, gosh. I don't know. It's had a few names over the years.
Okay.
I'm rewriting it again. It's got a new tone now.
Oh.
So, So, well, I have no idea when it's coming out. When it's done, it'll come out.
When it's done, it'll come out. Yeah. Who's in a rush these days for anything, right?
Right?
Do it in your own. Do it in your own time.
Yeah.
How long were you in Cairo for that?
So it was 6 months.
6 months, 7 days a week.
Oh, yeah. It was a lot of work. I realized after because I started to get this like jaw TMJ situation going on.
Okay.
And I thought it was an earache, but it was from singing too much.
Wow. I was just listening to a radio program because Phantom of the Opera on Broadway is finally closing.
Okay.
After, I don't know, 30 plus years, maybe even longer. And so they had, they were interviewing all of these musicians who thought maybe it'll be a 2 year run, but who've been playing there for decades.
Wow.
And they were, you know, as a consumer of music, I go, oh man, you know, one of the best things to do would be able to play music every single day. But these people are like, it's the same thing over and over.
Yeah.
And over again, you know, it was just fascinating to hear these stories of people that have been playing the same music
for
30
years.
You
would become so good at that.
But
it might be hard to do anything else. You just get locked in.
You might forget how to actually play the instrument outside of those songs that you play.
Yeah.
Wow.
After years of it, probably.
Yeah.
But there were times that I did get off. I went to, what was it called? It was an oasis, Siwa Oasis.
Okay.
And then, which is a run by women. And then I also got to go to Dahab. I'm not sure if you're familiar.
No.
It's so cool. It's across the Red Sea and it's all like this Bedouin village where the cushions are lining the Red Sea and there are camels hanging out and they bring you like hot nut yogurt drinks and like it's like amazing. So cool.
Oh, that was good. Yeah. I can't wait to read that chapter in your book.
Exactly.
What is the chapter called? Does the chapter have a title yet?
No.
That would be interesting.
Because there are many elements. I almost got kidnapped by a prince from Dubai who wanted me to join his harem. And seriously, there were so many things that happened there.
Okay.
You have to read the book.
You can't. Okay. we will read the book, but you can't just say you almost got kidnapped. And
I know.
So like, what happens? let's lead up to this almost kidnapping story. Oh my God. I'm glad you can laugh about it today.
Me too.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm lucky I'm tall. I don't know if you can tell, but I am tall. I think that has helped me through my life.
Okay.
To escape. Situations. I know when to run. And I was the fastest runner when I was a kid.
Oh,
fastest
my goodness.
Sprinter. So, yeah.
So you had to actually run, physically run.
Oh, yeah.
Oh my goodness.
I had to run out of a moving car. I had to escape. I had to escape.
Yeah. Oh, jeez. I'm so sorry, Lily. Oh my goodness.
I'm good.
Oh, that's good. It's good that you're good.
Yeah.
Wow. So this song Open Highway.
Yeah.
I watched the video.
Thank you.
Just so beautiful.
Thank you.
So filmed in Italy. So let's start from the top. Let's start about this song, Open Highway. Tell us about this song.
Yeah, it's interesting. That this song has almost become the song of the album, especially because we did the video, but it was sort of the pulse or the heart of the album for me, in the sense that it's about escapism. It's about fantasy and reality, fantasy versus reality. Can you escape in your mind, or can you ever really escape? Anyway, so the weird thing is that I did this thing as a younger person. Sorry, I keep saying thing. If we can edit it out.
Sure.
It was visualize the perfect place for you. What would that be? Where would it be? And for me, it was this balcony overlooking the Amalfi Coast, sipping an espresso.
Yeah.
That was my visualization. So then the years go by. That was probably 20 years ago. One, I would always say, people say, where are you going to end up? I'm like, in the Amalfi Coast, in a villa. Ha, ha, ha.
Yeah.
And then, so for this one, I thought, that's where the video can take place, and that'll be the way that I get there, is through the art. So I created the vision. It's just an illusion, it's a fantasy, but then it actually became a reality through the art. It's just whoa, it's all happening.
Yeah.
And I really wanted to recreate that shot of the balcony with the espresso. So all that stuff was my vision. I directed it, and it was pretty cool to be there. It's not what you think it is. You know what I mean? I feel like my imagination is always kind of better than the reality in a way. Because it wasn't easy to be there. Like, it's hard to navigate. Oh. It's hard to get around. It's hard to drive. It's hard to find the ocean. It's hard to do things.
It's like very rocky and hilly. Like, yeah. No one stays by the water. You're probably like miles away.
Yeah. And driving is insane. Like, sure. Luckily, Steve, we had four people. Steve was driving and he was very good at it. But you have to be really, it's like hairpin turns, you know, and like mm-hmm. barely any lighting, and just safety does not come first. Beauty comes first.
Yeah, of course.
So, yeah.
So when did you, it seemed, can I say that you filmed that this past summer, or was it before?
Yeah, that was the fall. It was in October. I think it was October, yeah.
Oh, wow, okay. Because I was going to ask, where are all the people? Like, you were in the water there, and it was like, it was not crowded, or did you have to go really early in the morning?
No, but the thing is, the people don't go in the water there because it's treacherous. Like, it's not a lovely little beach situation. It's like,
you're right.
And I think there might even be sharks, but we didn't know that. We didn't think about that till after.
Yeah.
We were blindly jumping in and, you know, all of it for the art and shooting underwater and stuff that I've always wanted to do.
Yeah.
I remember at one point, Steve, he was the DOP, and I could tell he was panicking. Like, we were in the boat and we were super nauseous, and he was like, yeah, maybe we'll just go back to shore. And I'm like, listen to me right now. Okay. What we're going to do is we're going to dive in and swim straight and front crawl underwater straight for shore. Don't stop, because these guys aren't going to save us. Cause I was looking over at Paul and Deb, and they were just like, like totally seasick. And Steve looked at me. He's like, okay. Go. I'm like, this is it, man. We're here now. We're doing it. We're not backing out. Like, what are we going to do? Go back to the hotel? Like, no, we got to do it.
Yeah.
And afterward, he's like, you're fierce. I'm like, well, I don't know what to say.
Was that your first time going to the Amalfi Coast?
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Okay. So all of those years of thinking, where's the perfect place? And you finally get to.
It's kind of weird because White Lotus was happening at the same time. There was a bit of a crossover.
Wait, was it filming there at the same time?
Yeah. Well, they were in Sicily, which is interesting. And my family had a recent trip to Hawaii, which also paralleled White Lotus. Like, I felt like White Lotus was paralleling my life at that time. But I think Sicily has better beaches, and I didn't know that at the time.
Ah.
I think, but I'm not sure.
Yeah. So it was my first time in Italy this past summer.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And I didn't get to the Amalfi Coast, but we went to Cinque Terre. I don't know if you're familiar. It's further north on the same side of Italy, a little bit further. I don't know if north is the right direction, but just further up.
Okay.
And it was like the most beautiful scenery. Mm-hmm. The town is there, and the town kind of spills into the ocean.
Yeah.
Or the sea.
Yeah.
And I remember
the Mediterranean Sea.
Yeah. And I just remember it being so hot we were there in August. It was so hot that I said, I don't need to walk the streets. I'm just going to get off of the train and just walk right down.
Yeah.
And I had my shorts on. So I said, I'm just going to take off my shirt and my hat, my backpack, and I'm just going to go and jump in the water.
Nice.
Yeah.
You did it?
Oh, yeah. We went to like four or five towns in a row. And every town, I just went into the water.
Good. Yeah. So yeah. Nice.
Oh, yeah.
It is hot there. It's hot. It was hot in October.
Wow. Okay.
Really hot. And we went up into where Ravel wrote his beautiful symphonies and wandered way up into this garden that had statues everywhere. We tried shooting there, but we got busted. We had to So that was like a constant thing, you know, because we had the gear, carrying heavy gear and rolling it and trying to be discreet at the same time. But most of the stuff was shot in the Airbnb. Like, we chose that location on purpose.
That's a beautiful location. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. Yeah. It was so nice.
Oh, wow.
Like the white pillars. And
yeah.
And I wanted to go for kind of like Sergio Leone meets, like, you know, Good, Bad, and the Ugly meets like Antonioni. So like the tight sort of black and white, small girly dress versus the like wide open kind of free, liberated, you know, energy to contrast. So like behind closed doors and in frames and then the wide open landscape to represent freedom. And
I really liked the video. It was really, really nice. Well shot. And I had to do a double take because, I mean, that's you swimming and that's you, that's you like in the Airbnb. Like, I don't know what's an Airbnb, but, yeah, they're like two totally different looks.
Exactly. So, it's supposed to be like above water is sort of the black and white world. And she's like in frames and there are mirrors and stuff. And then she, when she goes into the water, she becomes like color and liberated and open into open this whole new landscape. So,
well, Lily, let's take a break and have the video play and watch the video. Why don't we do that?
Okay, cool.
Else but here, take me to that long open highway. I wish I could be everywhere, but I'm just a particle in this vast cosmic ocean. Missing love terribly, I fear, but is it worth the pain? For what they say is gain. We are just scattered around, grasping for connection. Scattered around, grasping for survival. Traveling in my mind, sailing to a tropical desert. Such a struggle to be here, and though the moments pass, they are but all we have. We are just scattered around, grasping for connection. Scattered around, grasping for survival. Grasping for
Thank you, Lily. That's a great song and a great video for sure.
Thanks.
You're welcome. And this takes us to the paradise where you had your release party. Is that right?
Yeah.
The release party was there. So we're recording this on April 24th. The party was not too long ago, was it?
No, I mean, what? A little bit over 6 months ago, maybe.
So why did I think it was like just recently you had this big party there?
It was in and around October as well.
Ah.
So 6 months, yeah.
Okay. Something like that. Okay, too bad Greg isn't here because I would edit this part out. I sounded really strange there. Say it was not too long ago.
I played a little show like a week or so ago. Maybe
that's what I'm thinking of.
Thinking about that.
I saw, yeah, because I saw something on YouTube, or maybe it was on your website. I can't recall, but it was like, this just happened.
Yeah, I just played a little bookshop. That was fun.
The bookshop happened. Yeah. Okay, that's right. I saw that on your website. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, let's talk about the paradise from last fall.
Sure.
When the album came out, how was that? Was that your big sort of, big show?
The big hurrah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That must have been a lot of fun. It looked like a lot of fun on the videos that I saw.
It was fun. I just love having a bunch of people to sing in harmony with. I had Carly Aiken's voice. Oh my God, it's a dream. Danielle Bassell's, like, I feel like singing in harmony, if I'm going to keep going forward in this whole music world, is going to become essential, you know?
Okay.
It just feels so good. And it was weird because I put the band together for this one show, and it's not like we hit the road and started touring.
Yeah.
So, because I'm working in radio now, and like, I enjoy that. I just said to myself, like, if somebody picks up the show and says, hey, we'll pay you millions of dollars to tour the world, then maybe I would say yes. But that did not happen. So I'm good to just not. I'm just playing duo shows right now with Nicole Robertson. And that's great. I really like it because it's intimate. People listen to the words. Nicole's got a great sound, and I'm just going to do that for a bit.
Okay. And is that what the bookshop show was? A little bit of that?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. How is that? Like a nice, small, intimate,
tiny little literary crowd, you know, dark room, everyone listening.
Yeah.
Not a lot of extra sounds to get in the way. Like, some people said they really liked that. They could just hear the words.
Okay.
Yeah. It's a different energy for sure. The Paradise was a big show. Lots of people, big band, a light show, you know, like liquid light, not like lasers. There weren't lasers, but there was liquid light. Yeah. So, and then we had kind of a sing along at the end, which I love because I'm a bit of a hippie. I'm an honorary Vancouverite. And I love sing-alongs around the fire or sing-alongs around a piano. Anything that just connects people through music is great for me.
Yeah. Any sing-alongs at the bookstore? At the bookshop?
Nope. We didn't do that.
Yeah.
Lots of good chats, though.
How is it as a performer performing, you know, you're at the Paradise. People are dancing. People are up. People are singing. People are singing back to you at times, to going to a more intimate, quiet space and performing where you're not sure, like, are people, like, do you look at, is there foot tapping? Or are they nodding? You know, is their head moving to the, like, how do, like, do you as a performer need that immediate feedback, or are you waiting to when the song is done and they clap? I'm curious what type of performer you are when it comes to the crowd.
Yeah, it doesn't matter to me what kind of crowd it is. It just takes a bit of a different element of preparation for each one of those.
Yeah.
When it's intimate and stripped down, I need to really prepare my voice. Not to say that I wouldn't for a bigger show.
Yeah.
But because it's so stripped down, it needs to be like that's it. That's all you got, you know, like just be really strong. So I spent a week doing like pretty intensive vocal warm-ups. You know, on stage with the big show and the lights and all that, it's more about movement too, and like what you're wearing, and like, is there going to be a costume change? Like, what are the lights looking like? Like, this is a bigger production that we did video. If people want to see it, they can go see it on YouTube if they missed it. And yeah, there's a, there was a lot of coordination of people as well.
Sure, sure. Yeah, I can get it. One's a big performance where there's more than just you involved.
Yeah.
And one is like all eyes are on you.
Yeah.
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 And all ears are on you. Wow. Lily, we have a segment.
Yes.
Called Lost Venues.
Okay.
I'm wondering if you have a story from a venue that doesn't exist anymore. The story can be funny. The story can be sad. But really, we're looking for stories. I'm wondering if you have a story from a lost venue.
Yes, I do. So this one was in Vancouver.
Okay.
And it was called the Sugar Refinery. And it was upstairs, second level of Granville Street. And it was an all hours, like an after hours. So Vancouver's like kind of a day city. So it was tough to find action past 11 p.m. But the Sugar Refinery was one of the places where stuff happened. They made great vegetarian food. And there was always a PA set up with bands booked. And if the bands weren't playing, you could just get up and play. So, yeah, and you could do anything. Like at one point, so I had a proper band that played, you know, more mainstream venues and stuff out there. But then one night, I forget what we called ourselves, but we just, we all had like dark black around our eyes. And we just jammed and made stuff up in the moment. And it was so much fun. Like we were on the ground, like playing the bottom strings of the piano. And this was all good at the Sugar Refinery. Like no one even really blinked.
Sure.
Like this kind of expression and artfulness was like what you could let loose on the audience at the Sugar Refinery. So, and it bled out onto the back alley because everyone smoked, and like it just was such a free place. This guy Steve ran it, and then one day he just left. He went to Montreal, and it was closed down. And I was like, oh my God, I broke up with my boyfriend. I lost my record deal. My house got sold that I was renting, and the Sugar Refinery closed. I'm out. I left. I'm like, that's when I came back to Toronto.
Wow. That's a cool story. Thanks so much for sharing that.
You're welcome.
Yeah. You mentioned that you host a radio show. So you're still on Zoomer Radio, yeah?
Yes.
Okay. How is that as a former, no, I shouldn't say former musician. Oh my goodness. I was thinking of.
It's fine.
Yeah.
An old bag.
Yeah. But oh no, Lily, of course not. No. But how is that? Like you from going in front of a stage performing to now, you know, you're in a studio, you're, I don't know. They don't play records anymore on the radio, right?
Not vinyl.
Pressing buttons and,
It's a whole other world. And I did know, I had the impression that one day I would go into radio, but I didn't think it would be quite this soon in my life.
Okay.
Same with the book. Like I know that one day I'll release this book, but I don't know when it's going to happen. So I have three shows, two of them I host and one of them I curate, meaning it's my theme, my guests, my everything.
Okay.
They let me pretty much do what I want. I've been told I cannot play grunge. That's all I know.
That's
the only thing they told me I couldn't do.
Okay.
so I've had like conspiracy theory topics. I've had guest who was in the cult, the Mooney cult in LA. I've had, I don't know, people talking about transcendental meditation. I've had professors. I had Misha Bruger-Gossman. I don't know, like all sorts of guests. And it's so fun for me because it's very creative.
Yeah.
And I'm learning, you know, what's the tease? How to draw an audience in, like skills and tricks that are part of radio that that seem obvious, but it's not an obvious profession, like to become good. You know, I've had to train myself. There really wasn't a lot of training online and just with other hosts who've been there forever. I'm like, please, can you listen to what I'm doing? Critique it. Tell me what I can do better. Like, I really want this job, you know? Yeah. It's a cool way to like share all the years that I've been doing music, and also to highlight friends of mine who don't get played much, and I can bring them in and I can get them to play live. And it's cool. I really like it a lot.
Nice. So let's promote these three shows. Tell me about them and when people can find them on the radio.
Sure. So the station's called Zoomer Radio. On Saturdays, I have Live in the City at 2 o'clock, and that features a kids, K-I-D-Z segment. So I always feature someone who's like somewhere between 6 and 18 talking about how they love retro music too. Then at night, it's Saturday Night Bandstand. So it's like a dance party.
Okay.
Sunday at 6 is my show. It's called Zoomer Crooners and Songbirds, and it's a different guest or a different theme, and it's like 13 songs, and I just did a special on swing with Michael Lewis Johnson, who also is part of the Redwood in the East End of Toronto. It's like the swing resurgence night.
Okay.
And then I had Al Shiner on last Sunday. He's the guy who wrote 9, 6, 7, 11, 11 oh! and like all of the other jingles, like Marine Land and I don't know. He wrote like all the ones that you can't get out of your head. So
oh my goodness. That's an art in and of itself.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow. That just reminded me. You spoke earlier about this deal you have with this American outfit that gets your music on TV shows and movies and such. And of course, you know, your stuff has been on some iconic Canadian shows, you know, Being Erica, I believe is one of them. Tell me about that. Is there, obviously with this latest album of yours, Decompression, you didn't have television in mind or movies in mind, but tell me about this whole you don't have to tell me about the specific deal, but just the practice or of getting your music out into these different places that bring you as an artist money back to you.
TV show placements, like Battle of the World, how does that work?
Yeah,
it's becoming very popular because people realize that there can be money in there. But because it's becoming popular, the amount of money you can make is lessening. Okay. However, luckily, this deal is in the United States where there are many more people and many more opportunities. So, and I have to thank my brother because he got me the deal, which is crazy. Yeah. And because I trust him, he's my brother, right?
Yeah.
I put one of his songs on my record, Seagull, and he's an amazing songwriter, my brother, but he does this whole other job. He's a venture capitalist, and he solicited on my behalf.
Yeah.
And, he just believes in me. So it's so meaningful to me And he's like, your stuff is valuable content. Because I'm like, you know, no one's going to want to buy my catalog. Like, I'm not the Beatles or even anywhere close. So, and he said, but it's still content and it's still quality content. And that's what people want these days.
Yeah.
So he just had the confidence and the know-how to find out who to approach and how to do it. In the world of sync, like on a business level, some people are like, whatever, let's just get our song in a TV show. It's very competitive now. It's almost like what everybody wants instead of a record deal, because you could get discovered that way. I mean, Kate Bush had her resurgence through having Running Up That Hill on Stranger Things, you know, like all the kids love Kate Bush again.
Yeah.
I mean, it's TV is where it's at. So if you can get songs on TV, it can be really good. I had a big lull for a long time. I hope this whole thing becomes something again, because like when your songs are sitting there collecting dust, nobody's benefiting. And so I just want to get them out there again. And it's probably, it's like auditioning for a gig. It's like being an actor or something. Like you're auditioning your songs now. Like, you know, a TV show says we need a song about sunshine. And like all the sync reps come, you know, clamoring to the table. And they're like, well, we have an artist who's got a song about sunshine. They're all trying for that one gig.
Yeah.
And probably my friend Chris, who used to represent me in this, he said it's 1 in 30 that get synced. But I think it's probably less than that, but you have to constantly be auditioning your songs.
Yeah. It's another hustle, isn't it?
It's a full-time job.
Yeah.
And people just, they don't know, they don't get that. And not only do the songs have to be totally like prepared in this perfect format for the moment, and it has to be the right timing, because if you give them the wrong song at the wrong time, they won't trust you, and then they will not take your call again. It's, you know, like it's a real thing.
Yeah.
It's serious.
Wow. Have you ever written anything specifically for a TV show?
Well, being Erica, I did co-write that theme on purpose for that show.
Okay.
And I think that's the only time I did that. Okay. And it was interesting because I was much more metaphorical. I was like, you know, poets and laureates and crystals and blah, 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 like all sorts of random metaphors and abstract words. And the writer came to me and she's like, can you just be really literal and say, like, you know, we're moving from the current time to the past and this girl's traveling. She wants to rewrite the future. And I'm like, I don't know if I don't really write that way, but I had to, and I did, and it felt weird. And I, at my last show at the Sellers and Newell bookstore, I asked the audience if they could tell the difference between that style of writing, for that song compared to my others. And they said no. So it's like, it's just me. I just need to get over myself.
That's fascinating. That's really interesting. Lily, what you know, as someone who has a radio show as well, you're probably listening to all these types of music. What are you personally listening to these days? What's in your ears?
I have been listening to Bedouin lately. I just listened to her last night. I love her.
Okay.
She's a Middle Eastern kind of beatnik style artist, very melancholic. I listened to a little bit of Angel Olsen. You know, just thinking of what I listened to last night. I still like Beach House. My son's 16. He's almost 17. He's really into the psychedelic porn crumpets. Those guys are amazing.
All right.
Yeah.
I'll check them out.
They're actually amazing.
Okay.
So he's introducing me to a lot of cool stuff. I'm trying to remember some of the names of Mitsuka or something like that was one of them he was listening to. And then of course I love old, like heart-wrenching jazzy stuff still, like Billie Holiday.
Nice. The classics.
Yeah, I do like that still. Roy Orbison. I don't know.
Is your son following in your footsteps? Is he a musician?
He's training right now to be a DJ on radio. But he also plays bass. Yeah, he plays bass in a band. His band's called Sundial with a T.
Sundial. Okay. Nice.
I'm like, why the T? And he's like, why not, Mom?
Why not?
Yeah. They're really good.
That's really awesome. That's perfect. I'll keep my eye out for them. That's awesome. Lily, what's next for you? You've got the radio show. You've got a book that's coming out whenever it does come out.
Yeah.
Any more shows at at bookshops? Hmm. Any shows that you're planning in the near future? What's next?
Well, yeah, just because of the duo show I did with Nicole at the bookshop, we got two more offers to do private shows, like house parties.
Yeah.
One of them is outside in May, and in June we're heading up north to do another one. So I like that. At radio, I think what's going to happen is I might move into the TV zone a little bit.
Okay.
Kind of, we want to do a live show, kind of like bring back Electric Circus or something, that vibe, like a dance party. We'll see. I would love to do that.
Okay.
What else is on the radar? I don't know. I teach songwriting. I have my two kids. Like, I'm a single mom. I started a sisterhood in my neighborhood, which is an offshoot of the food bank that I volunteer at. So, and we bring music into that food bank. So that kind of community work, I really, really love a lot.
That is awesome. Good for you. Good for you. Lily, this has been fantastic. Thank you so much.
Thank for you your too, time. Kevin.
If people want to check out your music, check out what you're up to. Is there a website that people can go to? Where can people find out more about Lily Frost?
They can go to lilyfrost.com. They can go to lilyfrost.com on Instagram, or just Lily Frost on Facebook. Somebody just stole my identity on Facebook, my business page. We're working on resuming that, but otherwise all the other ones are up and running.
Perfect. lilyfrost.com. Yeah. Lily, thank you so much again for joining us. This has been a pleasure, a blast.
Thank you so much, Kareem. I appreciate it.